You are entering another person's language, cadence, heart, and mind.
This bottle I cut in half so that I could use it as a container to hold paint in and mix paint in. So a cheap version of a paint tub, really. It was an Evian bottle because I drink a lot of water when I'm in the studio, so there's always a lot of plastic bottles. This is a photocopy of a photo that I took when I was in Cuba. I went there after art school in 2006. And these chairs were in a building that we visited. I think it was in Trinidad, which is a small town near the sea. And these chairs were set up as if there was going to be a meeting, or maybe the meeting had already happened. I just liked the circle that it made with the empty space in the middle.
I think I will knock over a chair at this moment. Now the lodger beneath knows that I am alive at any rate. The walking woman. She's in New York. She's looking at her phone. I took a photo. I painted over it. I liked her trousers. And she looked calm. I put her behind a bit of cardboard that wrote New York on it, and I'd cut it in half. You could see through a window. And she was walking through the cardboard behind the words. Walking down the street, walking in the city, walking looking at your phone, walking watching someone, but they don't know that you're watching them. Walking on the pavement, walking in New York, walking through the city, walking through the photograph, walking through the cardboard, walking behind the window. Women who could pass through walls themselves constructed of apertures which allowed the breeze through, feeling that through these figures, with openings like windows, life could flow. The tower of egg trays I collected during the first year at Turps. There's a local cafe near the studio that we go to for lunch quite a lot, and the owner Oz used to collect them for me, and I'd pick them up every week. I wanted to have enough so I could make a tower that was taller than most people. The pink thing on the egg tray is one of my paper scrunchers. It's a bit of paper that I've scrunched up and then I've painted it. I bought this comb from a newsagent. It's from the basic needs section where you get things like safety pins and thread and bits and bobs. I don't know why I was attracted to it, probably because it was pink. Anyway, I bought it and I put it in my space and it just sat there for quite a long time and moved around and eventually became wedged behind a pipe close to the sleeping girl postcard that I have. And it stayed there for the rest of the year, and I wasn't really sure what it was doing there until we started the second year. And then one day I picked it up and thought, I can paint with this. So I started using it as if it was a paintbrush, combing things, but with paint.
Her decision to no longer use paint, but to learn with it, to understand its functioning in the most intimate sense of the term, to interrogate it while accepting its own exigent conditions. "I just don't feel like you're trying hard enough," one friend says to me. How can I tell her that not trying has become the whole point, the whole plan? It is also to see the painting for which one struggles, identified as a pollution of painting. Moderato Cantabile is a carefully woven tapestry of emotion, in which the characters' inner lives are reflected by the story's spaces and landscapes. This is the space where I am. I only existed here when I was painting. This is a postcard that's by Agnes Varda, the artist. She's a filmmaker. I ripped it in half. I don't know how long I've had it, it's just something I've carried around with me. The top half had a picture of Sophia Loren. I ripped that off and kept the woman. She's walking on the pavement, holding a note. She looks like she's going to deliver it to someone. Someone who's waiting for her. Or someone who doesn't know they are waiting for her. She is on her way. You can see the sun is beating down on the pavement. Her feet are barefoot. It looks hot, and she casts a shadow on the wall behind. Her black dress is moving in the breeze. You can't see her face, but I feel like she knows where she is going, and she is ready. Here is that road, maybe 1,000 miles long, and the woman walking down it isn't at mile one. I don't know how far she has to go, but I know she's not going backward, despite it all, and she's not walking alone. A woman both exists and is obliterated. Mum once said that she wanted to paint the way that Cecilia Bartoli sings. I'd like to paint the way that Helen Grimaud plays piano. I don't really know what I'm trying to do, apart from connect things together, make sense of them individually and as a whole, and take something from it that I can pass on to you. Actually, this song, Non Puoi Mester, sung by Bartoli, suits what I'm saying right now much better. Shit, Mum, you're right. I began to paint on plastic tablecloths that I bought from the pound shop. They gave a translucency that I really liked and had been looking for a long time. I had resisted canvas for this reason, it was too heavy. But it wasn't really the light that I was looking for, it was the moment to start painting. And once I found this, everything felt right. Vive l'orange, to live the orange, the writing's on the wall, the painting's on the wall. It hasn't left me. question, once it's formulated, is a paradigm, contains its own internal truth. We have to stop diverting ourselves with false questions. And I told Warren, I aim to be a female monster too. Is this a first-person female painting? The painting is not feminine as a result. It is merely speaking in first person, and that person is a woman. These things matter for those women who are addressing them, and because they matter, a true dilemma exists. Should one choose the proper manner to address them in the context of an internal struggle waged within painting? Or should one create an example of another way to practice painting as women? There is a conflict of loyalty, and taking a position here corresponds to a strategic choice. I think the sheer fact of women talking, being paradoxical, inexplicable, flip, self-destructive, but above all, public, is the most revolutionary thing in the world.
I always think more about in terms of human beings, and it's just the basic theme is just the need to belong.
To belong to someone, to belong to a...
To belong to something, to feel oneself a part of life. Because I think that these sources of creation are very mysterious, and I don't think one can find them by just looking for them. I think they have to come from within you.
Let us never cease from thinking, what is this studio in which we find ourselves? Think we must. I am the space where I am. I existed only when I was painting. Thank you.
I wrote it because I had something to say to you.